Alternative news media and the internet are awash with reports that the Fukushima nuclear disaster is wiping out sea life throughout the Pacific Ocean.
And this is from Natural News. I broke this. Dead sea creatures are covering 98% of the ocean floor off of California coast. And of course, the location and the timing of this massive die-off in the ocean points the finger at Fukushima as we see this massive amount of radiation that continues.
The Pacific Ocean is devoid of life. The great schools of tuna, gone. Sardines, gone. Anchovies, gone. Herring, virtually gone. The radiation has continued 25 hours a day, 8 days a week.
Fukushima will kill millions, many, many millions. The Pacific genocide, this is the greatest cover-up in human fucking history. This is a fucking war.
Are these alarming claims true? Is Fukushima really killing the Pacific Ocean? Let's put those reports to the test. Against their own sources, the scientific literature, and data on sea life in the Pacific. Scientists recently reported a decline in the number of species in the intertidal zone around the destroyed Fukushima nuclear power plant, relative to counts of species at further distance. Not surprisingly, they also found that intertidal species closer to the power plant had higher levels of nuclear contamination in their tissues. The inverse relationship between these two variables tends to suggest a dose response. However, the only part of the Pacific wherein a possible biological effect has been reported in the literature is in the intertidal zone near Fukushima. In the much broader region of the ocean off Japan, known as the benthic zone, scientists report that the community structure of sea life has not changed greatly since the tsunami and nuclear accident. In fact, many studies investigating radioactive contamination in sea life have collected scores of species off the shores of Fukushima, these being just four studies among many. So while there may be an impact limited to the intertidal zone near the nuclear plant, there does not appear to be a widespread impact on sea life communities, even right off the Fukushima shores, where radiation exposure was the highest. So if Fukushima is wiping out the Pacific Ocean, why is sea life right next to Fukushima largely intact? And wouldn't we expect to find that the Japanese fish market has collapsed? Let's do a YouTube search for Japanese fish markets, filtered for videos within the last year. Huh. World's largest fish market. Business is booming. Happy consumers. Don't these people know the Pacific Ocean is dead? Well, let's dive into one of these videos. No way. The shelves are filled with abundant seafood. All kinds of seafood. And the seafood inherently has levels of radioactive contamination below safety limits. Could it be that the Pacific genocide is just a big lie? To get the big picture, I consulted the Japanese Ministry of Agriculture, Forestry, and Fisheries, and dug up the data on fishing yields. Here are tons of fish harvested by Japanese fishers from the Pacific. The data reveal a slight decrease in fishing yields between 2008 and 2014, the most recent year available, but nothing that should lead us to believe that there was any kind of catastrophic impact on sea life abundance. So despite rumors of a Pacific genocide, in the real world, the Japanese fishing industry is thriving. Nevertheless, there have been recent reports of die-offs in the Pacific Ocean. Could those be caused by Fukushima? Die-offs, also known as mass mortality events, are nothing new. A recent meta-analysis of mass mortality events found that reports of them in the scientific literature have been increasing since 1940. While the causes attributed to mass mortality events are many and often complex, out of 727 mass mortality events identified by the authors, not one was attributed to radioactive pollution. While the authors were unable to determine if the increase in reported die-offs reflected an actual increase in their incidence or an increase in attention to the phenomenon, they did determine that the number of dead fish per die-off has been increasing. Each one of these green dots represents a mass mortality event of fish reported in the scientific literature before Fukushima. Yet since the Fukushima disaster, alternative media routinely attribute every fish die-off to Fukushima. But in looking at this big picture, certainly most of us can see the problem with that, which is that there's every reason to expect fish die-offs that have nothing to do with Fukushima will continue occurring and will continue to grow larger. So there's no reason to automatically presume that any fish die-off was caused by Fukushima. Now let's look at some big picture data for die-offs of marine mammals. The United States National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration has recorded 62 die-offs of marine mammals between 1991 and 2015. And here are those die-offs over that time frame. Notice that the year of Fukushima, 2011, is not particularly prominent, nor are the years thereafter. Yet these are die-offs that grabbed headline attention, triggering speculation that Fukushima was the cause. But when we look at the broader context, we can see that this number of die-offs could have been expected, even if the nuclear accident never happened. So on the face of it, there's no reason to presume that Fukushima caused these die-offs. Now let's examine some of the reports that portrayed these die-offs as consequences of Fukushima. Here, for example, is a news report on one of those mortality events, a die-off of seals along the Alaskan coast. The report claims that at the Alaska Marine Science Symposium, links to Fukushima were presented. However, those links were just a hypothetical scenario. What the report fails to tell us is that the scientists concluded that Fukushima fallout was not a radiological risk to those seals. And a recent study compared the levels of radioactive contamination in those seals to levels reported decades ago. This graph shows the level of the fallout product, cesium-137, measured in seals over time. The levels in 1968 were three orders of magnitude greater than in the seals tested in 2014, after Fukushima. This difference is because the fallout from nuclear weapons testing in the 1960s was far greater than from Fukushima. So if far higher levels of nuclear fallout didn't wipe out the seals and the Pacific Ocean, why would lesser amounts? And here's another news report about one of the marine mammal die-offs listed by NOAA, with a headline stating that scientists suspect Fukushima. Yet the scientist they quote, Kate Wayne, merely states that the cause is unknown. Then a responsible news source followed up on the story and interviewed Wayne, who said this about the dead whales, quote, levels of radiation in their tissues did not exceed background levels found in ocean waters, indicating Fukushima radiation exposure was not the cause of their death, end of quote. These two cases are a microcosm of how the alternative fear-mongering media works. They'll report about a die-off before the tests for radiation levels are in, and after the results come in, they'll never do a follow-up story telling us that the levels were too low for radiation to be the cause. Or they'll just grossly misrepresent a study.
And this is from Natural News. I broke this. Dead sea creatures are covering 98% of the ocean floor off of California coast, up from just 1% before Fukushima. A new study recently published in the journal Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences recently discovered that the number of dead sea creatures blanketing the floor of the Pacific is higher than it has been in the 24 years that they've been monitoring this.
In reality, that Natural News report was so wrong, the scientists who authored the study issued a press release stating that their findings have nothing to do with the Fukushima disaster. The die-off they reported was of only one species, salps, a jellyfish-like animal, in one location off California. The die-off occurred following an unusually large bloom of algae that the salps feed upon, resulting in a massive overabundance of salps.
When microscopic algae proliferate, salps devour them with extraordinary efficiency. They are the fastest-growing multicellular animals and are capable of explosive asexual reproduction.
Then, when the algae bloom died back, as they always do, there was a predictable die-off of salps, whose dead bodies covered 98% of the seafloor at Station M. This boom-bust pattern has been documented many times since the 1950s, and is not even hypothetically related to Fukushima. Yet the bogus story that it was made headlines throughout alternative media, spreading unnecessary fear far and wide. And possibly the biggest Fukushima die-off myth is the association of Fukushima with the die-off of starfish or sea stars along the coast of North America. But here are five reasons why this association is easy to dismiss. 1. The sea star wasting syndrome is only being reported around North America, not around Japan, where radiation levels were much higher. Moreover, 2. There's an overgrowth of sea stars around Japan. Fissures in the Sea of Japan, which has received more radiation than the west coast of North America, report an overabundance of starfish in their trawling yields.
鳥取で人手が大量発生。 底引き網漁に大きな影響が出ています。特産の貝も取れなくなるほどの大ピンチに、県が人手の駆除を始めました。モミジガイとトゲモミジガイの2種類の人手が増加。So
with sea stars thriving around Japan, there's no reason to believe Fukushima radiation is wiping them out in North America. 3. The sea star wasting syndrome has been observed along the California coast by scientists in 1997 and 2009, years before Fukushima. 4. Scientists say there's no evidence of an association with Fukushima. And 5. Scientists have identified a virus they believe is the cause of the sea star wasting syndrome. So just because this latest starfish die-off happened after Fukushima doesn't mean there's any association with Fukushima. Central to the Fukushima Pacific genocide narrative is that Fukushima is an extinction-level event that has caused the extinction of several species already.
As the Pacific Ocean is devoid of life, the great schools of tuna, gone. Sardines, gone. Anchovies, gone. Herring, virtually gone.
Wow, so many of the most popular sources of seafood are now extinct, yet you never heard about this in the news, huh? While this no doubt sounds crazy to most people, a sizable number take these claims seriously. So I've collected the most current data on the status of these species. Here we see catches of several varieties of Pacific tuna, none of which are decreasing after Fukushima. And here are catches of sardines and anchovy, recorded by the California Department of Fish and Wildlife. While sardines have been decreasing, they've been progressively decreasing since 2004, well before Fukushima. And anchovy have remained relatively constant throughout this period. So again, no obvious connection to Fukushima. And here are data for Pacific herring from British Columbia. Estimated spawn have been increasing steadily since Fukushima, whereas catches have remained relatively constant. Again, no evidence that Fukushima is causing any kind of extinction event. So fact-checking this claim of mass extinction yields a complete strikeout. None of these species are extinct, and most of them are thriving. These examples of Fukushima myth information hardly scratch the surface of the continuous output of a cottage industry of fear porn feeding off the Fukushima nuclear disaster and public ignorance about ionizing radiation. Perhaps the most remarkable thing about those who believe that Fukushima is killing the Pacific Ocean is that they can hold that extraordinary belief even without any radiation measurements that support that belief. Rational people believe that extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence, not blind faith. But at least one anti-nuclear group, calling themselves Radcast, takes the scientific approach of attempting to test for Fukushima fallout themselves by purchasing a relatively inexpensive gamma spectrometer that can detect specific isotopes, which, unlike a Geiger counter, allows you to determine if radiation is coming from Fukushima fallout. And they've used their gamma spectrometer to test seaweed and soil samples along the North American West Coast. Their measurements are compatible with those from institutions such as the University of California and the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute, all of which demonstrate at most minute traces of Fukushima fallout on the west coast of North America, levels of nuclear fallout far below levels seen in the 60s during weapons testing. So in fact, no radiation measurements from governments, independent institutions, or grassroots activists support the Pacific genocide narrative. So in review, we've observed evidence that the Fukushima disaster has reduced sea life abundance close to the nuclear plant and limited to the intertidal zone. However, there is no evidence of harm to sea life beyond the nearby intertidal zone. We've observed that the Japanese fishing industry is thriving, in stark contrast to the Pacific genocide narrative. We've observed that mass die-offs of species across the animal kingdom happened frequently before Fukushima, and so are to be expected after Fukushima, irrespective of Fukushima. And based on the historic trend, increasingly greater numbers of dead fish can be expected per die-off, with no relation to Fukushima. We've observed that alternative media reports linking die-offs to Fukushima are routinely false and misleading. In the real world, scientists have not linked any mass mortality event to Fukushima. And finally, we've observed that radiation testing conducted across the spectrum, from grassroots activists to institutions, converge on similar radiation levels that fall many orders of magnitude below lethal levels. In contrast, those claiming that Fukushima is causing a Pacific genocide have absolutely no radiation measurements to support their claims. The Fukushima Pacific genocide narrative is entirely based on ignorance, fallacious reasoning, and fantasy. If you enjoyed this video, please remember to like and share it, and subscribe to my channel. You might also be interested in some of my related videos presented here.